I can feel the ancestors here. When I was here 30 years ago, my son and I, he was 4 years old, he would come into the village all by himself and just play. And he would come back to the cabin and he would be singing Haida songs, which I never learned Haida songs when I was a child because it wasn't there. And he would come back and he would be singing Haida songs, and it would just like blow me away that he heard those songs. He said, "They're singing them in the village, Mama." And I was like, wow. The ancestors, you could just feel them around you, and that they are here with us.
This is a really important village site with beautiful monumental Haida art in recent times, but the history here is so rich. It's not just that snapshot in time.
I'm just sort of looking through these rocks and seeing to see if any are distinctly modified by Kunisi.
The deep time component is what we're doing right now, shovel testing on higher elevation portions of the island, which correlate with when relative sea levels used to be higher.
SGang Gwaay would have looked a lot more like a bit of a reef. And then as the sea level recedes, you have village sites that travel with the shoreline all the way down.
Sea level maximum would have been about 17 meters above modern, about 10,000 years ago, and then slowly dropping. So we're kind of aiming for any old beach landforms that are about 17 meter high elevation.
The evidence was found where there was some cultural middens, and it just follows up that there was at one point a village in that site. It just would have been 15 meters higher than where sea level is today.
We dug some shovel test in and encountered some really rich black soils with firecrack rock, with animal bones, with lots of shell, and all these signatures of cultural activity, plus some stone tools.
This is the old barbecue.
We'll get radiocarbon dates, so we have to run those winter. So those provide absolute dates for the site.
Once those samples are dated, we're going to be able to just have a higher resolution understanding of how the ancestors behaved every day and what their diet looked like.
Yeah, this is definitely another village site on island.
Seeing how greasy that dirt was is incredible because it indicates how rich the diet was, and digging through the middens here and finding those sites made me feel really warm inside because you're able to sort of look back across that breadth of time and know that your ancestors were feeling full and happy and doing the same things that we do today, you know, eating together on the beach.
Oh, cool. So this is a big chunk of quartz.
Last year, we're finding some broken quartz in the houses. Some of them had sharp edges, some kind of seemed like the edges were battered.
Yeah, it doesn't break away on a clean blade.
Yeah, there's lots of fractures in it, so
it's hard to tell if that was like a natural breakage or something someone was intentionally making into a tool. So when we identified this quarry site, that really just solidified that thought process that these were being intentionally made tools.
Need a quick knife.
Yeah.
Go to the quartz quarry.
This year we've added to that body of knowledge, so we're seeing a whole network of little quarry sites or micro quarries all over the island. This was a super convenient raw material. People were just getting locally right outside the village. They had been hammering bedrock and a quartz vein in that bedrock with a hammer stone.
It's a really fast and easy way to make a knife. And so a lot of the lithics that we find in a lot of the sites here are little tiny sharp stones. And that's exactly what we're looking at, is that process of removing quartz and breaking it and getting those really sharp little bits so that you can create knives.
People are just finding a local material, making a quick knife, do its job, and then can dispose of it quite easily because it's a pretty common material type.
We're still doing the same things that we see at this site. Haida people are living in similar ways and they're practicing the same traditions and they are eating in a similar way.
That was a really good one.
Yeah, this is sweet. A good one.
Yeah.
So sweet. I don't know why they're so sweet here, but it's really tasty.
I feel like that's really quite comforting, you know, to know that the Kunisi were here behaving the exact same way that we do today. Of course, an enormous amount of has changed in the last 150 years. But in a way, by participating in those same traditions of sharing food together on the beach, like, we reflect our ancestors and become closer to them.
Asisla esta. That means, here you go.
We also are refining our knowledge about the paints and pigments that we were finding last year in the house. So we're finding some ochres, which is a mineral pigment, often a red color, and we're finding grinding stones. And we're wondering, like, how are these grinding stones being used? Were they used as pencils or as crayons? You can see this red here, and we actually found the abrader stone that was used to grind it into a powder. And then we did find the paint in a horse clam last year.
It's really nice to have that process, you know, in a step by step, and not that we've lost that knowledge. That knowledge has always been around, but it's nice to have the evidence.
This pigment was used for, you know, painting bentwood boxes, for painting poles, but also for painting the body and face paint.
A lot of the objects that we recover from these sites were in use very recently, and a lot of Haida objects are intended to and built to be danced, to be celebrated, to participate in the human experience, and to be living members of the community.
Some of our younger crew, they actually were using that pigment that's just come out of the ground from an old longhouse here. And so what they were doing was using the pigment to color in their form line tattoos, which was so cool. The thought of when the last time that pigment was used to present day with our traditional hand, stick and poke tattoos and our youth using it, expressing themselves in an artistic way, it fills me with pride.
It's so wild that, you know, you sit somewhere and you think, wow, this was how many thousands of years ago someone sat right where I'm sitting, and that's what I feel, like the rustle of the earth, the shaking of the earth, and it's like sand or real fine water just falling on you, and it's just like, just makes your spirit happy.
With our oral histories, we've known we've been here for a long time. But what's really nice about this sort of work is that it really brings that extra supporting material forward to just show that our oral history is accurate and it does mean something.
The combination of traditional knowledge and science coming together, and so we create like a much clearer picture of what Kunisi, what our ancestors looked at in their world.
This is one small island in Haida territory, and every inch of this island was being used in some capacity or another. We're kind of starting to fill in those gaps in the time periods of human activity and occupation on this island. So I'm really excited about being able to come back next year, do a little more investigation at these older sites, and then compare them so we can get a chronological comparison for the last, hopefully, 10,000 years of Haida activity on SGang Gwaay.
It just makes me feel really excited and proud that it's showing how long the Haidas have been here. Like, you always get that question as a watchman. So how do you know? How do you know that you've been here for thousands of years? Now I can say I was in SGang Gwaay and this is what they found, and I got to see the levels. Like, it was like, oh, yeah. We've been here 10,000 years or more.
Aya way.